All right, they've arrived. Actually, only two out of three boxes have arrived, which is a little concerning. But I'm hoping the third one will be here any day as well. At any rate, even if it doesn't show up for a little while, we have a lot more new things to tide us over. As you saw, there's a lot of exciting things. There's like foreign androids that I can see just already having opened the box. As you saw too, a lot of them I didn't buy. This one my friend bought for another friend of his, I believe. A lot of the stuff in here is not mine, but I'm just gonna show it to you anyways, and hopefully I can keep track of what is supposed to go where. So yeah, the Kratos one is strange to me. I'm not sure who would want a shirtless, bearded man screaming as an android, but I suppose I kind of get it for like the juxtaposition, you know. The cuteness that comes from something that isn't cute being put in cute proportions. A little less extreme but similar, we have Mikasa from Attack on Titan. Again, very badass. She's pretty well suited to be an android though. You know, I don't know. It's pretty cool. She doesn't have any smiling faces though. It's just like aghast and concentrated on killing. And then I guess the other facial expression is covering up with the scarf thing. She smiles sometimes in the manga, though. Oh wait, no, she's also got this, the battle rage. There we have Rin from Fate Stay Night. It's the tsundere girl, is my understanding. I don't know. I don't know anything about Fate. But yeah, another Nendoroid. Yet another Nendoroid. Not bought by me, but bought by my friends 02 from Darling in the Franxx. I've already said my piece on this show, but I do think 02 is a really awesome character design. I can understand why she's so popular and why my friend wanted this Nendoroid. I like the hat that she comes with a lot. She comes with hat and coat, which is awesome. Plus the lollipop that you can have her licking. It's pretty cool. All right, enough of other people's stuff. Here's some of my stuff. We got Mia Fuji from Strike Witches. OG, I got this for very cheap, 1400 yen. It's so cheap for an Android. You would never see an Android for sale in North America for anything less than $20, $25. And that's like the absolute cheapest. Yeah, I was pretty excited to get her. I really like this character. You know, Strike Witches in general, I have mixed feelings on, but I think the character designs are great, and Mia Fuji especially, I think is great. She reminds me of Saki a lot, you know, especially when she starts getting like ultra powerful. Just that really kind of like unassuming monster level power, and the juxtaposition between that and this sort of like civilian mode, the sort of personality she has when she's not out wantonly blowing up the Neri, whatever they're called. Oh, we got even more Nendoroids. I'm just gonna hit you with the all Nendoroid blitz. I got Sane as well, my Toho Nendoroid collection getting almost finished. There's a few I don't have, Komeji and what's her face? Sunflowers girl. But most of the ones that are my favorite, I quite like. The only one that I'm missing that I really want is Alice. I couldn't find Alice for a price I wanted to pay. But Sane was pretty cheap, 2800 yen for Sane, who's one of my favorite Toho characters. So I don't know why I didn't already even have this to begin with, but I'm happy to have it now. All right, so that's six Nendoroids we pulled out of this box. I see even more. But let's look at some books and stuff first. I got these Kankole doujinshi that looks really cute. Yeah, they look really cute. It looks like I might be able to get through most of this too. Just looking randomly at pages, I can understand a decent amount. It's like tough to know when it looks like it has kind of a children's book appeal. That either means that it genuinely is kind of like a simple, innocent, fun story, and that I might be able to read it. You know, something that kind of aims for like a yatsuba sort of feeling. Or it's like really strange and subversive, and I'll have no idea what's going on. It's a hard 50-50. There's this. I think this came as like part of a set. I think a friend of mine wanted that. I got this, which is the second volume of Karage Taro's serialized manga, Kafi Kohi Kantata. I have no idea why this isn't being localized or scanlated at least. It looks fantastic from what I've muddled through the first volume. I don't know if it's just that there aren't RAWs available. If there's not, I can maybe facilitate that. Go back to the old me, if you will. I don't know, it looks great. Karage Taro is just such an amazing storyteller, and his art is so fantastically expressive. I don't know why I have to go to such lengths to buy his work. It seems fairly popular in Japan, too. Like, this was prominently advertised. So probably it's going to take until someone makes an anime of it for all you Western nerds to clue in to the genius that is Karage Taro. This is something I got at Comic Cat. It's a full-on tankobon just of Yomo and Yuyako. That's her name, right? Yuyako. With other Toho antics in between. I've read this guy's Yuri Dijinchi on a number of occasions before. I think he does a great job with this pairing. It's pretty awesome that he has a whole book of just this one pairing. I think that's so cool. I've talked about it at some length, how cool I think that is already. This one is strange. It's the Moomin Kankole thing, where one of the abyssals, for some reason, has just continually being drawn as like a troll from Moomin. Okay. I don't know why, but I really like Moomin. And I think this is just so weird that I had to have it. I just had to have it. It's just one of those things that you have to have. This is a Kimono Friends book. Maybe this was for someone else. I don't know, it looks pretty cool. I hope I bought it, but maybe someone else bought it. This is the mystery that we're going to have to unravel. This, I'm very, very happy with. Very, very proud of. This I got when I bought the Mezashi set that was available at Comic Cut, which I had to line up for. It is a supplementary little bonus chapter of the semi-series. Like, he's made a few doujins of when Hanamaru is a college student and Yoshiko is an office lady, and they start living together. This is a brief little follow-up, but a really fantastic-looking follow-up that I'm going to treasure forever. Oh, right. Okay, so this is Kaizen Taikoku, or Sakasana, who does a lot of Saki Dojinshi. He had one called Joint Training Camp, which is one of my favorites. He has a few others focusing on the pairing of the girl with really long sleeves, that they have the reservation pairing. They're really, really good. I really liked his work. I thought his art was adorable, and I don't know if it's a boy or a girl. I'm saying his kind of automatically. This I'm not actually sure what it's like actually a derivative work of. It could even be original for all I know. But it's their latest work, so I was eager to buy it, no matter what it was, just to add to my Sakasana collection. And then they're also doing Land of the Lustrious doujinshi, which looks quite interesting. I haven't finished this series, neither the anime or the manga, because I'm a horrible, horrible person, but I've really enjoyed what I have seen. And I think it's a cool fit for this sort of story that Sakasana likes to tell. So that was cool, too. Good Comic Cat haul, for sure. This is another Kimono Friends thing that I may have bought, or my friend may have bought, or we may have bought for another friend. But it looks pretty cool. They've really nailed the art style of the anime. Nobody claims it. I'm just gonna say I bought it. My plan is just to, like, I'm hoping my friends that ask me to buy stuff will remember what they asked me to buy, and then I'll just kind of let them sort through. This I remember. I bought for sure. I remember seeing this and being so impressed that it has within it pictures of the real animals. Now that to me is just beautiful and genius. That you love kimono friends, and that in turn spreads to a love of the animals on which these characters are based. So you make a fun book, the Kimono Friends fun book, that has both the characters and the animals. I love it, I love it. That sort of love was baked right in to the first season of the show. Remember during the between acts part, like during the commercial break, they would always interview someone from a zoo and talk to you about, you know, what's going on with the real animals. I love that. I love that. This I got, it's a Love Live! Rin Haneo fan book. I've read a few things by this artist before. This is a very, very cute pairing, I think. You just kind of go all out on the cuteness, and it's fantastic. This is another one by the same author. There's snap. There's some postcards in here. These are postcards from various other things, too. All right, sweet. We got that. But then we also got the Rego postcard. Sweet. We got a Yomu postcard. We have some other Toho postcard. We have some postcards from Rinu Goro, whose book I bought in quadruplicate because a lot of my friends wanted it. Rinu Goro, of course, the author of Senko-san, the manga that has taken the world by storm. Speaking of which, I have here volume 3 of Senko-san. I already got the first two volumes we saw in previous videos, those I bought later and brought home with me. This one I just bought right away for some reason. I don't know. I just could not resist it. Such is the power of the Fox Cult. If you don't know about the series, just be careful. Just be careful. It's like maybe too strong a dose for most people. And here's volume 3 of Kurage-taro's cafe comedy, which again, why am I trying to read this with my pathetic Japanese? Surely someone out there, one of you beautiful scanlators, will do all the work for me. No? Wouldn't you love to? What else we got? I got another big Yomu book. Just because... Oh wait, no, my friend got this one. I remember he was showing me this. And I was like, dang, I wish I got this one. But no, he just got one. Big Yomu art book. If you just want to look at drawings of Yomu all day, every day, you can do it. Now we make a sudden jump to the literary. This is Inio Asano's manga, Reiraku, which is about his divorce primarily, I think. I don't know if you can make it out in the video, but there's like an embossed, hidden text besides the text that's in white. But yeah, this looks like probably one of his most down-to-earth, brutally depressing human dramas. I can't wait to read it and get the big sad. So yeah, my Inio Asano collection remains nearly perfect, I believe. Of course, there's a lot of merchandise and stuff I don't have, but of the manga he's made, I'm at almost 100%. So that's good. There's a gigantic stack of doujinshi. It's probably going to take a while to go through. This one, oh no, the pages got bent a little bit. But this is another Inio Asano manga. This one looks completely insane. Yes, it looks completely insane. I just tried to flip through to kind of repair these pages, and I saw some things I probably shouldn't have, you know, for the sake of spoilers, but... I think the strangeness of this story kind of resists spoilers to begin with. Oh well. That's like one casualty. Everything else seems like it made it through okay. This just was kind of an unfortunate spot. But, it'll work itself out. Yeah, there's a big stack of doujinshi here. I don't think we're going to be able to talk about all of this. Are you ready? Are you ready for a fistful of doujinshi?
Oh,
that's a lot of thin books. That's more thin books than I have any given thick book, I believe. You can just look at the variety of the spines is really engrossing, too. Yeah, I don't think we can talk about each and every one of these. We'll be here all day. Plus, like, half of them or more aren't even mine. So, if I talk about how cool they are, it's only going to make me jealous. That was just getting warmed up, by the way. Are you ready? For round two? For another one? This is another one that we're going to put on top of the first one and make a pile that is truly an affront to God. Truly. The Tower of Babel reincarnate. We have like various little packing papers and stuff in here. This is something a friend of mine bought. Oh wait, I can't really get it out yet. This is Flander Nendoroid that my friend bought. I already have it, you know. So, I can just throw this in the trash. Nah. Ugh. Lordy, lordy, lordy. Are you ready? Here comes another one.
It's just another big pile of doujinshi. How did this happen? Oh my lord. Oh, it's becoming so terrifying.
Alright. And then one more. It's not over yet.
Okay. Get another stack of doujinshi. You know how it is. What? Wait, what? My friend found this?
Oh my lord. Alright. Dang it. Dang it. You got some treasures that I didn't even know about. Alright. Is there any way that I can...
I guess I can just turn the camera. Are you ready?
That is a fat stack. That's just nonsense. Look at that. Good God Almighty. You fall off of that thing, and you're sure as heck gonna be speaking different languages for years to come.
Oh my lord. Okay, let's do like a quick blitz through these, and I'll point out any ones that I think are especially worth talking about. This is the Rimogoro one that I was talking about before, the author who makes Senko-san. We have one, two? Maybe they got separated. I have a few more of these though too. Oh wait, maybe I already gave the other two to other friends. I don't know. I don't really remember who I was buying them for. Okay. This is some Toho thing, some other Toho thing. Oh, these are good. So it's Eurocamp at Toho! Wow, how cute, how awesome. And then at the same booth, inexplicably, there was like an artist team up, and it was also Eurocamp, but Toho, but Muscly Man. Which I've seen this author before. This is like his thing. But why? Why is it his thing? And then I read a bit of each of them, and it's like the stories are similar, but divergent in many ways. Appropriate to the different sensibilities of these different modes of characterization. And so on and so forth. Oh my gosh, we got so many doujinshi. Just a bunch of Toho stuff. Just a bunch of Gaudapan and others. I don't even know what character that is. Oh, this one looks interesting. I thought this had really nice art. So I bought it. And interior, too, it has a really unique art style, I think. Just that kind of softness. It almost looks like chalk drawing in some ways, you know? I don't know. I'm really into it. Lots and lots of Toho things. And this is the other Rimugoro book, which again, I should have more copies of somewhere. But for now, I'm just working on making a big, cool-looking pile of stuff that I bought, or that other people bought, and then at some other point, I'll sort out who gets what. And here's another Rimugoro again. We bought lots of copies of it. I used the power of the tactical weapon, my friend that I stood in line with. This is the Mezashi Dojinshi that they were selling at Comic Con, but I got the little bonus booklet with, just somewhere here. I should really be careful with that one because it's just a couple pages stapled together. It looks cute too. I don't think it's in the collection that I bought later, the summary. So I don't even know if I've read scanlations of this one. This might be just like brand new to me, which is hype. Pretty hype. Hopefully I can figure out what's going on. La, 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 la. I got this pretty low-budget Hidemari sketch one. It's just some papers stapled together. But again, if you reject things like this, then you reject the spirit of Comic Cat itself. And the art is quite cute. I just really like that she has this kind of like frozen fruit popsicle thing, because those are cool. That's something I can definitely see them making on that show. There's still so many Toshinshi. Oh my god. I'd say like maybe half of these are mine, but it's hard to know for sure. It's like some of them I can remember buying. I remember buying this because I collect this series and I didn't have this one yet. What is this? I don't know. So a lot of these came from the bargain bins at Tori Noana and Mandarake and K-Books and other such things, which is a section where they just, they have a big pile of doujinshi that you can buy for typically 100 yen each, which is just crazy. It's like really hard to pass up something if it's 100 yen and you feel like you'll probably never see it again, which is likely true. But it certainly feels like it's true in the moment. Plus, there's just so much cool stuff. Like, it only takes a second to start flipping through it and thinking again of the indomitable doujinshi spirit, the capability of people to make and produce these works. You start feeling pretty moved, right? And then it's like, how can you not? Oh, this is a good one. This is the Kaze-san doujinshi that Hiromi was selling at Comic-Con. It wasn't Hiromi herself, unfortunately. When I went in 2014, I met Hiromi herself and bought the doujin of that point. But this is a new doujinshi made, like, after the OVA, after the localization, after the long serialization. So that's awesome that Hiromi is still out here making doujinshi just for the real ones. It looks super cute, too. I can't wait to see what's going on here. This is, like, part of a Kimono Friends series. My friend asked me to get this. It looks really funny. I kind of wish I had gotten some for myself, too.
It looks very, very funny.
We got more stuff. These I got, it's from Daioshin, who does the Toho comics that look like this, and now has done some Idolmaster comics that look like this too. His booth was right next to my friend's booth. It was right across the hall. So, I was able to buy the premium set really early in the morning when I was helping set up, which is here. This is the doujin itself that they're selling. It looks awesome. His humor, I think, is so hilarious. There's some, like, really, really different guest pages in the back, too. Like, mostly it's like this. I kind of meant to bring... I have his Toho Tankobon, his collection of Toho books, and I sort of wanted to get him to sign it, but I forgot to bring it, and his booth was also super crowded, even that early in the morning. So, I don't know. Didn't seem worth it. Here's my friend's book. Yay! I think there's like 4 copies in here. So I bought a bunch for people. I don't know what that is. Okay. Oh, so much attention. It just never stops. La, 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 la. Okay, let's grab the next chunk. This looks interesting. A lot of these I've seen for the first time too, because my friend bought them, and then I didn't see them. And when he was packing them or anything. Is this a fun video? Watching me just like toss books into a pile. I don't know if this is fun or not. I'm gonna make a... At the end, it'll have the same sort of finale as the other buying stuff videos. So don't worry about that. Oh, there's this. I guess I should show you this. Just so you too can remember forever that this exists. Fist of the North Animal. Okay. It's the final push. What's in this stack? Sure. There's like a lot of Kimono Friends doujinshi, which made me very happy. Because I love Kimono Friends. I forgot I got that. That's a good one. Makes a nice slapping sound when it hits the pile, don't you think? Dang, I don't think this is mine, but it looks so good. Okay. We're nearing the end. Alright. That's it for doujinshi. For this box. That's it for doujinshi. We still have a few other things in here, though. This I alluded to earlier. A friend of mine bought this who's into gunpla stuff. It's some sort of gunpla kit. I don't really know what it's going to build. But, yeah, that's for him. And then we got some CDs. I did a bit of CD shopping, too. I bought LCD Sound System Sound of Silver, continuing my pattern of always buying at least one Western CD that I could have easily bought at home. I got a really good price for it, though. It was at a used CD place. I think it was only 300 yen. And it was really funny. So I bought this, and then I'm back in the capsule hotel, and I can hear my friend, like, humming. It's like, ah. Hey, is that Sound of Silver? He's like, yeah, that's Sound of Silver. I was like, oh, do you know what I just bought today? So what we figure is that he must have seen it, because he was in the same store as me. He doesn't really remember seeing it specifically, but he was in that store. So he may have seen it, just kind of started thinking about it, and then started humming it later. But it still felt like a really insane coincidence when it happened. It was like a little unreal. This I think I bought.
Maybe my friend bought it. I think I bought this at Comic Con because it was labeled as post-rock. Yeah, I mostly remember this. This was at a booth, and the booth said it was post-rock, so I was like, hell yes. It remains to be seen whether or not it's actually going to sound like post-rock, but post-rock is actually a pretty meaningless genre. Usually it just means that they like the same sorts of bands that I like, i.e. post-rock bands, and thus I'll probably appreciate whatever they're doing on this. So that seems good. I got the Yuru Camp soundtrack. Hell yeah, I love the soundtrack so much. It just seemed like a good piece of Eurocamp merch to have, given how much the soundtrack was like integral to my love of this series. So I was glad to get it. Anime soundtracks are expensive, but it's definitely worth it. Well, this is also part of my plan to buy a Western CD. This is my new Western CD. I always get at least one of these before I buy it. Riff Raff's Neon Icon and Tyler, the Creator's Goblin on my previous two trips to Japan. This time I got Teyana Taylor's KTSE, Keep That Same Energy, an album that I really, really loved, that I praised heavily in my top albums of the year list, if you've watched that. So I was like, oh, cool, I'll buy this. I got this! This is so cool! All right, check this out. This is the album itself. It's Tristan Parrish's One Bit Symphony. And I'm showing you the wrong side of it, actually. That's why the lettering is backwards. So this is something I'd actually heard quite a while ago. I had seen an MP3 download of it. Oh, shoot. One of the things looks like it got knocked loose of its casing. But this is the album. And there's a headphone jack here. And a battery here. This is on-off and a volume knob. I don't know what this button does, actually. Maybe that advances to the next track or something. And it just will play through the all of the sounds that it can make. You just listen to it through here. It's really neat. I think that's such a cool idea. It is indeed one-bit music, whereas you think of most things have a bit depth of 16 or 32. Things like the Game Boy produced 4-bit music. You think of the SNES as 16-bit music, whatever. This is literally 1-bit music. So expect too much. And then, this is cool too, it has all of the actual instructions printed in these liner notes that this very simple piece of programmable hardware is following. So yeah, I was amazed when I saw this. I hadn't thought about this thing in quite a while. Just this existence. And suddenly it was actually here. So that was such a cool find. And then, yeah, later that night we were out and we listened to it. I was like, oh, cool. Yeah, I have my earbuds right here. You can check it out. See if it works. And it did. And now I can plug my really fancy, very expensive headphones into this. And get the full one-bit experience. So yeah, that's pretty cool. I got this Jun Tonegawa CD. I like Jun Tonegawa quite a bit. And this is some crazy mix of like a bunch of her music, I think. I'm not really sure what to make of it, but it has a few of her big hits that I really liked that were on the Vampilia remix, remake, collaboration, cover type album experience thing. So yeah, I'm not really sure what this is, but I thought it was pretty cool looking, and I just couldn't help myself, man. I can't give that sophisticated of a reason for much of this, because, you know, I just spent my money like water in Japan. here we have Goqualia, a kind of glitch, orchestral, post, whatever, band that's on Virgin Babylon. I quite like this album. I got it for cheap. And then we have Moom's Summer Make Good,
which I'm not actually sure what this is.
Let's open this up, because I don't really remember what's on here. And this is the last thing, too. So we'll spend a little bit more time,
because I know that the video isn't going to suddenly turn into be an hour long or something.
Oh, okay. Oh, right.
All right, so I do know what this album is. This is just their 2004 album. For some reason, I thought it was called something else, and that this might have been, like, a promotional thing around there, because there's a track on here called Will the Summer Make Good for All Our Sins, which I've always really liked. It's my favorite song they've done since I thought they were making really, really good albums. The rest of this album, I think, is, like, okay. But Will the Summer Make Good for, like, All of Our Sins, I think, is, like, fantastic. And I knew that the album was called something different than that, but I didn't know it was just called Summer Make Good. I think I thought it was called something else. But whatever, I'm glad to have this. This is still a fine album. I just really like their earlier stuff way, way better. Even Will the Summer Make Good for All Our Sins, which I think is a fantastic song, is good in ways that their earlier stuff, like, just, I don't know, whatever. All right, that's box one. We made it through one. There's another one soon. But the third one, I don't even know what's up with that. So, like, part of me wants to just, I don't know. There's no good way to do this. I kind of want to do, like, a super omega spread where I just put absolutely everything that I got in Japan all out on the couch at once. But then I'd have to go and, like, get stuff off of my shelves and stuff that I've already kind of put away where they belong. It's like, it just doesn't seem worth it. So, I don't know. We'll probably do box number two on some other occasion. Yeah. That's all for now. I wonder if I can do this without seeing. Stop the video from recording. I bet it's somewhere around here.